I'm so happy to be here. This is my favorite. I love UFM. So it's a pleasure to be able to share with you here. And I'd like to start this presentation by asking you, what do words really mean? So, like, when you have a word and you're trying to get a definition for the word, you often go to a dictionary, right? Over decades, the definitions for words change. And often dictionaries will change their definitions as a consequence. But how do we really know what a word means? Like, if you have the word bottle, you can clearly see this is a bottle. Well, it's got a napkin on it and things like that. But what do you do when you have a word like altruism or truth or consequences? What do you do about these kinds of words? How do you know what they really mean? As it turns out, what is happening now with large language models like ChatGPT is they're giving us a new way to understand words. And this is super helpful for you as students. And we'll be talking about that. So, you know, we should talk a little bit about how these ChatGPT and things like that actually work. So when I say ChatGPT is a large language model, what I'm really meaning is that it's ChatGPT and Claude and some of the other, you know, generative AI mechanisms are analyzing millions and millions of words in a helpful way for us. What they do is they use what's called word vectors to help them understand what words mean. So let's take the word ability. Ability, you can't like take a picture of ability, you know, and understand what ability is because it's a little bit abstract. But what large language models can do is they can go out to the web and look at millions of pages and analyze the word ability with all the context that that word is found in. So it's almost like it's like putting a spear through hundreds of thousands of web pages right where it uses the word ability. And it says what words are around that word. What is the context of the word ability? And what you often find is there are other related words that are often found nearby. So they seem to have some kind of meaning that is similar to the word ability. So if you look and you look at all, you know, like let's take 30,000 words, which are conventionally thought to be enough to quantify a language. If you take those 30,000 words and you like cluster meaningful words together, so like you might find man often is, you know, in the same semantic area as woman. Mattress might be found with couch and furniture and things like that. A house might be found close to the word street. Words clustered together by their meaning. And if you look here, you can see a really nice diagram that gives you a sense of how words and their meanings can cluster together. This is showing it in three-dimensional space. But the real way that large language models analyze these things is in a space that has tens of thousands of dimensions. This has three dimensions, or it's trying to project three dimensions, but large language models actually analyze words in a dimension that is, you know, in a huge number of dimensions. So let's, here, I'll just give you an example of what I mean. The word happy has all of these relationships with all these other words. So see all these numbers put together? That's the vector, that's the relationship of the word happy with thousands of other words. So every single word has thousands of relationships, but you can quantify it with one number, a vector number. So if you can quantify a word with a number, you can relate words to one another. So let's relate words. Let's take the word cat and see how its context compares with the word cat. So cat, cat, it's the same word. So you would think it has pretty much the same context. Indeed, cat compared with cat has a context of one, like 100%. That means it's always found in the cat context. That's no surprise. Let's try the word cat compared to the word dog. Oh, sometimes the contexts are a little bit different. Cats are quite different than dogs, but at the same time, they're both pets. So a lot of times, cat and dog are found in very similar contexts. The overlap between these two words is a 0.74. So that's like, they're similar. They often overlap in their meanings, but not 100%. Let's take computer, like a laptop, compared to alligator. Well, they're not found in the same context very often. No surprise. What about altruism compared to benevolence? Well, they're often found in the same context. They're not the same, but they're very similar in their context. So I was mentioning that there's actually hundreds of thousands, even millions of dimensions that these word vectors kind of live in. But you can flatten them all out and look at a shadow in three-dimensional space. So that's what this is doing right here. It's kind of giving you an indication of how these word vectors relate to one another. So let's look at man and woman. If you look, there's the relationship like king and queen, it has the same direction and the same length. So somehow, you know, that maleness, femaleness is related in a similar way. Likewise, when you have walking versus walked and swimming versus swam, so it's, you know, something present tense, something, you know, present progressive and past tense. There's a similar relationship between these in the vector world. If you look at countries and their capitals, similar vector relationship between all of these. So all of this is a little bit of background. This is what these large language models are doing. They're analyzing the relationships between words. And what does ChatGPT actually really do? If you look, so let's take a sentence, any random sentence we want. So our sentence is, why did the koala burp lightly while reciting pi to 50 places. Random sentence. So these large language models are trained by going out and looking at what's going on the web. And it is also like making guesses about words to develop an understanding of the relationship with a word. It'll say, you know, why did the koala burp? You know, and it'll guess the next word. And oftentimes it'll be wrong with what that word is, but it's learning what are standard sentences. How can these sentences be put together? So in any case, what large language models are doing, they're figuring out the relationships between words. And that's a key to them being able to answer your questions. But look at what happens when you're relating the words in one sentence. That's actually a lot of different relationships. I only showed a few of those relationships here. And for a long time, for decades, there was a real problem in the development of generative AI because they just couldn't figure out how to get computers to hold much information in mind. So look here. It's like they would start a sentence, and by the time they get to the end of the sentence that you were trying to analyze using these large language models, it would have already forgotten what the beginning of the sentence is. They didn't know how to build it so it could hold these, you know, the relationships between words. So do you remember, like, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, translations were really bad? So you'd go to, you know, Google Translate, and you'd put something in, and it would translate, but mostly word by word. So some things just didn't make sense. In English, we have the expression that a person is a wet blanket. That means they're kind of a boring person at a party, or for example. So wet blanket. If you translated that into Spanish, would that make any sense? I mean, does a wet blanket mean a boring person in Spanish? It just means a wet blanket, doesn't it? So it has a special meaning. You have to remember that wet and blanket go together and have this special meaning. And these large language models, they weren't large enough. They couldn't put things together. But gradually, they started being able to put together a couple of words. And then, all of a sudden, they could put together and remember paragraphs. And then they started being able to remember not only entire sentences and paragraphs, but pages and pages of things. And what the real magic was that made this happen is this paper right here. This paper is Attention Is All You Need, and it was published by Google engineers in 2017. Now, you might say, research papers, who reads those? Because most of the time, people, you know, it's like five people may read a research paper. This paper has been cited over 100,000 times. It's tremendously important. And why is that? It's because this paper introduced the idea of the transformer. And the transformer is what makes the magic of large language models. So don't worry, I'm not going to go through all the details. But a transformer, it takes language that you've, you know, like the sentence that I had about koalas. It takes one by one, takes those words in, but it's actually kind of combining them together and making it and connecting it with other sentences that are out there. And then what it's doing is it's taking and coming up, it looks at a few words in the sentence, mixes them up a little bit, and says, here's the answer to your sentence. So this device with the encoder and decoder is the transformer. And what's really cool about this transformer is that this transformer, see how it's like, it takes a word, feeds that word back through the output, feeds it back through until the end of the paragraph or whatever it's generating for you. This is very similar to how the human brain is analyzing these things. In fact, transformers and large language models themselves are inspired by how the human brain works. So this gives us some clues about the direction we should go in order to best make use of large language models. So we've already talked, and I've spoken here about how the brain really works when we're learning. A quick review is just that we know that the building block, the fundamental building block, or a fundamental building block of the brain is the neuron. There's about 86 billion of them. And what this neuron does is it connects with other neurons, sends a signal during that connection process. And this is what is happening in our brain as we are beginning to learn and remember something. So as you're learning something, you're simply making connections between neurons in long-term memory. And so you get a cluster of neurons as you're learning something. And when you practice with whatever you're learning, you're strengthening those neural connections. If you don't practice with what you're learning, well, your little synaptic janitors can sweep those connections away. But ultimately, you're making a nice set of neural links, and they grow strong, and you're able to easily pull them to mind when you need to. But this, notice, you get a concept in mind that you've learned, and once you have a concept in mind, what's really cool, that concept can serve, if it's somewhat similar to something new you're learning, you can use that initial concept to help you more easily learn a new idea. For example, by using a metaphor. So the metaphor I love to give as an electrical engineer is that water flow, the flow of water molecules, is somewhat similar to the flow of electrical current, electrons as they're flowing along. So we can use the idea of water flow to help us understand electrical current flow. Of course, it's not a perfect metaphor because if you get down to quantum levels, that idea breaks down. But, you know, whenever a metaphor breaks down, you just get a new metaphor. So how do we come up with metaphors? ChatGPT. ChatGPT is so good at coming up with metaphors that it is absolutely amazing. Okay, so here's something I wanted to talk about was dopamine. Dopamine, they often call dopamine the feel-good molecule. It really is the molecule of anticipation. It's why we, you know, we're like looking forward to things. And dopamine is released when we get an unexpected surprise, pleasant surprise. So what is happening in your brain is we have this dopamine system. It can send dopamine throughout the brain. And what what happens is, if we're really, if we're curious about something, then when we can solve or understand whatever we're curious about, we actually get that, oh, surprise, and it releases dopamine in the brain. So they found, for example, that little mice that have their dopamine systems inactivated can't learn anything new. So there's something magical about dopamine that helps you learn better. So this gives you a little sense of what dopamine is doing when you're learning things. So let's say you're trying to figure out some problem, and you're a little curious about what the answer is. So you try to work this problem, and you can't get the solution. So you try again, still no solution. So you try yet again, no solution. You keep trying, and eventually, you actually stumble across the right answer. And when you do that, you go, ah, I got it. And that sprinkles dopamine along the pathway that you just did, and it helps cement the connections between neurons. That's those links of learning that form whenever you are learning something. So what's fascinating is when you form these links like this, that, you know, because you're a little curious about something, you learn it better. A little bit of curiosity helps you to cement in those connections. So of course, some of the practice, you know, little problems that are like, you were good, you went wrong, so you didn't actually solve it, but you learned little aspects that you were able to put together that helped you solve the problem. So some of the initial efforts you made were worthwhile too. But when you're curious about something, what that does is fascinating. It helps you to focus more intently. So, and literally what it can do is it will, like, part of your visual field will gray out as you're focusing more intently on whatever that is that you're learning. So this is a very important aspect of learning. And so what does that mean? It means use ChatGPT and other large language models to help you be curious. So working memory is what you can hold temporarily in mind. You can only hold about four things in average, four pieces of information on average in your mind. Those pieces of information can be bigger if you've practiced with the information. But in any case, your long-term memory is kind of like these set of lockers. And within the lockers are, of course, all those links of long-term memory. So when you're learning something, your working memory is working to make sets of links, and ultimately, it's storing those links in long-term memory where if you want to get them, you can pull them out and use them. So what you're doing when you're learning some, or like on a test or something like that, you can come up with your limited working memory and pull out sets of links related to information you've practiced with and really learned. Unless, of course, you haven't really practiced with it, in which case it kind of flies away. Working memory capacities vary. So on average, people have four things they can hold in working memory. Some people have lesser capacity working memory, like me. Others have very large working memory capacity. Here's the interesting thing. So large language models have an infinite, virtually infinite capacity working memory. we can only hold a little information in mind at once, temporarily, as we're consciously thinking about it. But ChatGPT and Claude and all these other large language models, they can hold enormous amounts of information all at once in their mind. So this is part of the value is, like, I can't imagine what a K-12 teacher experiences. So it's hard for me to look at things from the perspective of a K-12 teacher. But if I put one of my papers into ChatGPT and say, read my paper, I have to give a talk to K-12 teachers about this paper, give me an abstract with the ideas that describes what my talk will be about, it knows a lot about the world of kindergarten through 12th grade teachers live in, and it can give me a really nice abstract. And indeed, I've done this kind of thing. So keep in mind that also what ChatGPT can do is synthesize the essence of ideas. Have you ever noticed your favorite professor, you know, who can simplify and give you the essence of something really difficult to understand? ChatGPT can do this for you. So all these large language models are really helpful private tutors. So as you're using these large language models, just keep in mind, as I said, it knows millions of things. So sometimes it's hard for it to focus, right? Even with the attention it's got. But you can use it for all sorts of things. Like, you're learning another language. Well, type your conversation in and say, you know, I'm trying to learn German. So here's, you know, please converse with me in German. You can ask it retrieval questions about whatever you're learning. What are the key ideas I should practice with? And you can ask it for case studies. You can ask it for all sorts of things. Just explore what are the different large language models out there. So with that, I would just love to thank you for having me here, and I hope this might help you in your learning.